Good morning, everybody. Myself is Professor Syed Zaur Rahman. I'm working in the Department of Pharmacology for the last 2 decades. My area of specialization is for environmental pharmacology as well as other areas of the pharmacology. Here I'm going to discuss and present with you a relation to the pharmaceutics in environment. So I hope you would like this topic, because we all know that the environment is polluted not only by industrial pollutants, chemical pollutants, but we are also concerned with the entry of drugs through various routes into the environment. So the background of my presentation is, you know, that newer and more effective drugs are being manufactured and used in an ever-growing scale. And these drugs which are manufactured, they are for both medical and non-medical reasons. And the demand for these drugs and the pharmaceutical products, they are destroying the countless number of species of both animals and plants. And this led to the public at risk and disappearance of the rainforest around the globe. And because of this disappearance of rainforest, this also led to the loss of rainforest and changes in the global climate. So with this growing area and the research in the field of ecology and environment, many adverse effects of drugs on environment has also come to the light. In pharmacology, there is a discipline which is called as pharmacovigilance. And pharmacovigilance is all about the activities related to monitor on any adverse effects in human and animals. But we are less concerned with the drugs which pose harm to the environment. So this discipline is called as environmental pharmacology. So I hope you would like this environmental pharmacology topic, because you know, drugs are being used in both medical and non-medical condition, and when they are disposed and excreted from the human body, they enter into the environment, in both aquatic and terrestrial environment. So the first study that detects the drugs in the sewage took place in 1976 in the Big Blue River sewage treatment plant in the Kansas City of the USA. And then in the meantime, various studies and various findings came to the light related to the rising levels of some drugs and their adverse effects on both flora and fauna. So this these findings in the sewage treatment plant and in other aquatic and terrestrial environment, this led to the alertness of the regulatory bodies, both the FDA of the USA and the European Union, which is the European Medicine Evaluation Agency. So they started regulating these drugs which are entering into the environment, but still there is a lack of substantial protocol for prospective monitoring of drugs concentration in environment and evident adverse effect. We don't know what could happen if these drugs enter into the environment. So there is a need to understand the topics like gene environment interactions, drug environment interaction, and the toxin environmental interaction. So there is a need of closer collaboration between environmental sciences and medical communities, which these people may then address the gap in this area. So after this brief introduction, and we all know that environment is polluted not only by heavy metals, pesticides, emissions from the cars, trucks and other gasoline engines, but also pharmaceutical chemicals. And when these pharmaceuticals enter into the environment, sometimes some drugs which we consume, they have double lives. Double lives means if that drug is taken and has done its work in the body for any reason, for therapeutic purpose, and after excretion it takes another life, which is called as double lives. And these renewed lives in environment, then they pose harm to the environment. So we can say that these pharmaceuticals, they are entering into the environment through various routes, like from the industrial industries and also from human body as metabolite or as active substances. So human health and ecology may well turn out to be more intimately related than ever imagined. So this is a diagram which you can see that this is designed by Doughton, and he is showing that drugs are entering into the environment through excretion, like through feces or through urine, and sometimes disposal of drug. This is another diagram which you can where you can see that these drugs which you have just seen, they are entering into the environment either through excretion led to the substances into the sewage, and from sewage it goes to the sewage treatment plant, and from sewage treatment plant it is going into the soil as well as into the surface water. And from surface water we are taking these drugs through our drinking water. Similarly, if we dispose the drug, these disposal they then go to the waste substances or to the incineration. So from the incineration or incinerator, it goes to the air, and from waste it goes to land site or landfill, and then to the groundwater, and from groundwater again we are taking these drugs through our drinking water. Same thing here again shown that there are two types of drugs, like one is given in human, one is given in veterinary sciences. If you can see, if you see in this diagram, then you can see that drugs which are also consumed in the aquaculture, livestock and poultry, and from these livestock things, the drugs from their excreta enter into the manure, and these manures are then used in the agricultural land, and from agricultural land we all know that we consume foods and vegetables, and so indirectly drugs are entering into the human body from the veterinary site. Similarly, if you see human medicine, as you have already seen that drugs are excreted from the human body, it goes to the sewage, and from the sewage treatment plant, and the sludge and the surface water, and again drinking water. And if we dispose the drug, then it goes to the dustbin and landfill, and from landfill again to the drinking water. And sometimes we also notice that from the sewage there is an overflow or there is seepage, and that seepage leads to the water, into the groundwater, and from groundwater drinking water. So it is also found that you have seen that there are various routes of entry of these drugs into the environment, and these are the list of drugs which were found in the environment, and list antibiotics, hormones, painkillers, tranquilizers, anti-cancer, various antidepressants and beta blockers. And these drugs obviously found in the surface water, groundwater and drinking water. And the important thing is, these are the drugs which we consume for our diseases, for therapeutic purposes, both in humans and animals. Similarly, apart from these therapeutic drugs, there are traces of cocaine, and these traces of cocaine were detected in the River Thames in England. Cocaine is snorted, and it is also excreted from our urine and feces. Similarly, other groups of drugs like radioactive material, they are also excreted from our carcinoma patients. And sometimes while synthesis of drugs and before consumption, they are when excreted into the environment, they persist similarly persist in the environment if the drugs which comes from as a metabolite from the excretion, like for example clofibric acid. So clofibric acid is a drug which persists in the environment. So these drugs, when enter into the environment, they cause some harmful effects. So we can call it after effects. So we don't know the after effects of these drugs in the environment. So there is a concern about the unexpectedness of these reactions. For example, we all know that the antibiotics which are not used rationally and in many areas, like you have seen in veterinary medicine as well as human medicine, this led to the development of resistance, and it's a major concern. So antibiotic resistance, and similarly you might have heard about the vultures extinction. So vultures, they actually consume carcasses of the livestock, and livestock have already the active form of the diclofenac sodium, and diclofenac sodium led to the death of vultures and the extinction. Similarly, the contraceptives like ethinyl estradiol, which enter into the environment, this causes the effeminization of male fish and suffer the virility of the frogs. Similarly, antidepressant drugs you have seen also found in the environment, for example, fluoxetine. This fluoxetine presence starts triggering in the shellfish. So shellfish start laying egg in presence of fluoxetine. Similarly, these antidepressant drugs causes aggressiveness in lobsters and irreversible damage in aquatic vertebrates and invertebrates. For example, venlafaxine causes the foot detachment of freshwater snail and changes in the memory of cattlefish. This is the after effects of antibiotic resistance. You all know that antibiotics resistance, the multi-drug resistance or extensive drug resistance with the antibiotics is a major concern. We don't have many antibiotics for the serious infections. Same thing which I was telling about the diclofenac sodium, this led to the decline of vultures, and this is not only a problem in the extinction of vultures, but also it poses problem in the, for example, certain traditions of the Parsis. Parsis, they, you know that they dispose their dead bodies to the elements rather than burying or cremating. So they put their dead bodies in the towers of silence, which is also called as dakhma. When they put these dead bodies for the vultures eating, so vultures eat them quickly and consume them. When vultures are vanishing, then they have, that's why they have stopped putting the dead bodies in the towers of silence. This is a diagram which you can appreciate. One fish is welcoming the male fish. So this is the feminization of male fish because of the contraceptives which are thrown in the aquatic environment. This is a diagram where you can see the in presence of antidepressant drugs, shellfish start laying eggs. This is called a spawning. There is also aggressiveness in lobsters in presence of antidepressants. Anti-cancer drugs which are consumed by the cancer patients. Although very less amount of anti-cancer drugs are found in the environment, especially in the aquatic environment, and in amount of 1 to 5 nanogram per liter. These are the drugs which are commonly found, cyclophosphamide, cisplatin, methotrexate and other protein kinase inhibitors. And it is also found that these anti-cancer drugs, they are toxic to the crustacean Cerodaphnia dubia. So you may see that drugs which are entering into the environment from the human as well as the from the animal bodies, they are posing harm to the aquatic and terrestrial environment. This is another diagram where you can appreciate that cocaine is detected in River Thames of England. Cocaine is snorted by most of the Londoners, and cocaine is entering through urine and through excreta, so feces, into the river. And Sunday Telegraph reported that cocaine is found in this river in an amount of 2 kg, which is equivalent to 80,000 lines per day. So indirectly from the sewage treatment plant, it is again going into the drinking water to the persons who are not taking cocaine, and they are taking cocaine indirectly. Similarly, in this diagram, you can see that the radioactive material, when they are excreted from the carcinoma patient, for example, tramadol and eribulin, they are excreted both from feces and urine and entering into the environment. So, tramadol is mainly excreted from the kidney and from the urine. So, most of 90% of the tramadol is excreted through the urine. So, there are some drugs which persist in the environment, like after entering into the environment, they remain in the environment. So, we calculate the persistence, which is calculated through the dissipation time in the water and sediment samples. And as per the dissipation time, we have classified drugs into the low persistent, moderate persistent, and highly persistent. So drugs like paracetamol, ibuprofen, and carbamazole, they are in the group of low persistent, means they remain in the environment for 3 to 7 days. Similarly, drugs which are comes under moderately persistent, for example, oxazepam, iopromide, they remain in the environment for 15 to 54 days. The highly persistent drugs, they remain in the environment for 119 to 328 days. Similarly, there are drugs like sulfonamides. They are degraded in the environment, depend on the amount of light, pH of the water, presence of oxygen, and influence of weather. So, depending on these factors, sulfonamides persist in the environment. So, this is persistence of drug in the environment. If we come to the next part, then we can say that not only the therapeutic drugs, but non-therapeutic drugs, which we call it pharmaceuticals, personal care products, in short PPCPs. So, PPCPs are also entering into the environment. And many traces of PPCs are found in the environment, including the insect repellents and incinerators, which converts the bio-waste into the chemical waste. So these PPCPs, they are entering into the environment not only from the living organism. We have also seen Minamata tragedy, the mercury poisoning, and mercury poisoning led to the consumption of mercury in the fish. And when humans started eating that contaminated fish with mercury, there was mercury poisoning in the human body. Similarly, pesticides which are used in food stuffs, like in wheat flour, soft drinks, they are also taken indirectly into the human body. Another important aspect in relation to environmental pharmacology is endocrine disruptors. Endocrine disruptors are those substances which influence and disrupt the endocrine system of our body. And when these endocrine systems is disturbed, it affects the health as well as the progeny and the subpopulation. So, this includes the pharmaceuticals and personal care products, as well as the therapeutic substances. There is a huge list of drugs, both steroids and non-steroidal pharmaceuticals and personal care products, in like disinfectants, fragrances, lots of antibiotics, analgesia, veterinary growth hormones. So, not only the antibiotics which are consumed in the veterinary science, but also the growth promoters. So, they also disturb the human body and the endocrine system. So, after seeing all these things and the issue of environmental pharmacology, this is discussed in the regulatory bodies also, and these regulatory bodies, they came up with certain guidelines. Although these guidelines has cut-off limit for the environmental concentration of drugs, but little concern is given in the research to find the after effects of these drugs on environment, especially drugs which we consume at therapeutic doses. So during the clinical trial, there's a need to submit the data in relation to environmental risk assessment. We know that there are phases of clinical trials and there are some shortcomings in the clinical trial. For example, limited size of the population, narrow group of people, narrow indications. These clinical trials are done for a short period of time. Similarly, it is found that evaluation of drugs on environment is practiced very minimally. So if we go to the history, then we can say that although these regulatory bodies, both in America and the European Union, they have some guidelines. For example, in USA, the guidelines is present since 1977 for the new drug application. So for every new drug application, they have to submit the environmental risk assessment. Similarly, the European Union guidelines for environmental risk assessment are also available since 1996, and they have revised their guidelines in 2006. So in both these guidelines, they cover the procedure for new active pharmaceutical substances and its metabolite, and also the excipients which are used while adding in the medicine as flavoring agents, as coloring agents to increase the shelf life and for preservation. So excipients also need to show the environmental risk assessment data. So the potential environmental risk could be after the use of drugs by the people, and storage and the disposal of medicine. So recommendation are also there in these guidelines for how to keep the drugs and how to dispose the drugs to limit the product's environmental impact. So usually in the environmental risk assessment guidelines in both US FDA and EMEA, there are five questions which form the basis. For example, number one, does the compound bioaccumulate? If yes, is it degradable, biodegradable, or no, not? Similarly, after the bioaccumulation, where the drug is going? Either in the atmosphere, soil, or water, or if it is going in these terrestrial or aquatic environment, how much of the drug is entering into these areas, and is it toxic there, or how can we reduce the environmental risk posed by the drug? These are the five questions which are usually normally form the basis of the environmental risk assessment guidelines. So underlying principle for both these guidelines for environmental risk assessment is almost the same. They are interested to know the predicted environmental concentration, how my drug is entering into the environment, then its effect, whether acute effect on the living organism, or chronic effect, or fate of the drug, whether it is biodegradable, in which form. Here you can appreciate these basic principles. Fate means the drug undergoing like biodegradation, metabolism, photolysis, hydrolysis. Similarly, in the physical properties like water solubility, lipid solubility, adsorption. So this comes under fate, the fate of the drug. Similarly, while calculating the how much drug is entering into the environment, the environmental concentration, we need to have some calculations. And effect, as I have told, the acute or the chronic effects on the environment. So these are some definitions which are usually calculated while seeing the effect of drugs in the environment. Maximum expected environmental concentration, which is the more than expectation, like expected introduction concentration, which is called as EIC, expected environmental concentration EEC. Similarly, we calculate median effective concentration EC and median lethal concentration. So these are some calculations while seeing the concentration of drugs in the environment, EIC and PEC, and you can see here the formulas for calculating EIC and PEC. I'm not going into the details of how we can calculate, but there are some formulas for calculating all these things. So after calculating all these concentration, Then we decide if the risk assessment is conclude that the environmental introduction concentration is less than 1 part per billion, then drugs assumed to pose acceptable risk. If it is more than 1 part per billion, then we go for the clinical trial. No phase one if the concentration of the drug in the environment is more than 1 part per million, then environmental risk assessment is required. So in the clinical trials, US FDA does this study in the tier, they follow the three-tier approach, tier 1, tier 2, tier 3. In tier 1, acute testing on one species, and tier 2, acute testing on three or more species, and tier 3 is for chronic testing. But these guidelines does not cover, so there are some limitations of these guidelines. Risk posed by synthesis. While synthesis of the drugs, sometimes drugs are entering into the environment, so they are doing only the clinical trials, so they are not doing studies in relation to the synthesis or manufacture of drugs. What about the drugs which are already has come into the market? Why, before marketing there are trials, but what about the drugs which has already come into the market? No actual testing is conducted after drug is marketed to see the environmental concentration and its estimation correctly. So periodical check is not done, and fate analysis is also not done. So this post-marketing surveillance of therapeutic drugs which are entering into the environment should come in a discipline of pharmacoenvironmentology. So little concern and research is done to find effects on environment, particularly the drugs which are given at therapeutic doses. Pharmacoenvironmentology. This is a paper which we published and tried to cover the topics which should come under pharmacoenvironmentology. And as I said, is a component of pharmacovigilance. So this is an extension of pharmacovigilance. So drugs which are entering into the environment at therapeutic doses and pose harm. So this comes under pharmacoenvironmentology. As I said, there are some limitations, and these are something like when a drug has come into the market, this is because of the loopholes while clinical trials, and there is something like future legislation is not there, which requires environmental risk assessment of the drugs already on market, because we don't know who will do the environmental risk assessment, because during the clinical trials, usually the principal investigator, they do the clinical trial, but after the marketing, there is sometimes originators of a drug of a no longer the main manufacturers, and manufacturing monitoring may be difficult of the drugs which are already on the market for years. Some drugs are taken in combination, so chances of drug interactions and two or more drugs when they are consumed, they are also taken into account and they are excreted into the environment at the same time. So how drug pose risk may be handled from the addition of labels and change of labels after the proper disposals of drugs. So this is something about the European Medicine Evaluation Agency, and you can see that in 2006 they revised their guidelines. So this is European Medicine Evaluation Agency. They also follow, unlike FDA guidelines, the environmental risk assessment in two phases. In phase one, they estimate the environmental concentration of medicinal products, and in phase two, they are concerned with the information about the fate and effects of drugs in the environment. So in phase 1, the concentration of drug in the environment, and in phase 2, the fate and effects of the drugs in the environment. But phase 2 is done in two phases, tier A and tier B, in two parts, and they also authorize and try to do the environmental risk assessment for the drugs which are used in the animals. So this European Medicine Evaluation, they do the study in phase 1 and in phase 2. As I said, phase 1 is in relation to the estimation of drug in the environment, phase 2 for the fate and effects, and phase 2 is divided into tier A and tier B. If there is a need for tier B, then they go to the tier B. So this help in the minimization of the cost. You know that clinical trial is very costly affair. It requires billions of dollars. So in tier B, they extend the study in relation to the fate and effects of the drugs. So phase 1 is basically, as I said, they are interested to know the environmental concentration. Does the compound bioaccumulate? If yes, then is it degradable? So for this, they do some calculations. Like for example, in bioaccumulation, the primary, which is the primary indicator. So for this, they calculate octanol water partition coefficient. This water octanol water partition coefficient is also an indicator to show that the drug is lipid soluble or non-ionized form in the organic fractions in of soil sediments or biosolids. Then how much drug is there in the environment. For this, they calculate predicted environmental concentration. So this is all about the calculations about the predicted environmental concentration, especially market penetration factor is there. So after knowing the market penetration concentration and the maximum daily dose consumed per inhabitant, which is called as dose A EI, and then this is multiplied by the market penetration factor, and then we have this predicted environmental concentration with this formula, product of the recommended maximum dose multiplied by the penetration marketing divided by the wastewater per inhabitant per day, and with some factors of dilution. So this is in short, phase 1, we calculate the log of the octanol water partition coefficient. If log octanol water coefficient is more than 4.5, then we go persistent biodegradable testing, and also PEC calculation. If more than 2, more than 0.01 microgram per liter, then we go for phase 2. If it is less than 0.01, then there is no effects are expected, so no further testing is necessary. In phase 2 tier A, if it is risk, then we go for tier B, which I've said that it is an extended study. Same thing here, calculations, the predicted environmental concentration and the predicted no effect concentration, which is PNEC, and no observed effect concentration. So these are the calculations which are very important to find out the fate and effects of drugs. Outcome of tier A, if it is yes, then we go for tier B, which is extended environmental fate and effect analysis. This is some same thing which is shown here. So tier B is the extended environmental fate and effect analysis, and this is also done by performing further tests, including the aerobic and anaerobic transformation in soil, soil microorganism, nitrogen transformation test, terrestrial plants, growth test, earthworm, acute toxicity test, columbola reproduction test. So these are the extended form of the studies in relation to fate and effects, like in FDA, which we do the acute and chronic effects. So this is in short and in briefly what is done in phase 1. Phase 1 is pre-screening, and action is taken, and this is the data which is required, log octanol water coefficient. Phase 2 is further divided into tier A and tier B. So tier A is for screening for the fate and effect, and tier B is extended form. So all these are tier A and tier B is for the risk assessment. There is a slight difference between European Medicine Evaluation and the FDA guidelines for the fate analysis, and this is just a difference of the dilution factor of 10. And the FDA, you know, they are interested to know the chronic testing if acute testing indicates a risk. This is additional in the FDA. Now comes to the another part, which is the animal models. So you have seen that especially in tier B, they require some extended study. For this, we need to have models for the environmental risk assessment. So models, they are used in calculating and estimating the environmental risk assessment. So as a part of the good clinical trial, studies on impact of particular drugs on environment is also very important. And as I said, there's a discipline which is pharmacoenvironmentology, and there we need to know the exact concentration of therapeutic drugs which is entering into the environment. Although some scientists, like for example Richard and Koch in 2007, proposed some mechanistic approach to the exposure analysis of environmental risk assessment, and there are other genomic and physiological indicators of effects of pharmaceuticals on aquatic studied in aquatic environment, but no appropriate model is available for the study of or the impact of therapeutic drugs which are entering into the terrestrial environment. So this is a model, genomic and physiological indicators of effects of pharmaceuticals on aquatic organisms. So this is a fat head minnow. The zoological name is Pymphalus promilas. This is a native bait fish in Wisconsin, and this is a good model for environmental studies and toxicological study. For example, clofibric acid is found to affect this fish, especially in the opercular movement, which is flap over gill. And naproxen sodium also showed changes in swimming behavior in this particular drug. Another model is the Daphnia. The presence of drug tells about the survival, growth and reproduction of the drugs in this species. The two types of biopsies are done, acute exposure to simulate an environmental pulse and chronic exposure. As I said, there was no proper model for the screening of drugs as a part of environmental risk assessment in the terrestrial environment. This is a model which we propose, this is a model which you can see in the diagram, that drugs are taken by animals, and the animals then their excreta, they are collected in the soil, and the soils with this part of the plant which are grown in this soils are analyzed in the lab, and these then plants are fed into the animals, and then the animals toxicological studies are done, and the drugs which are contaminated by these plants, so the parts of the plants are also analyzed. So indirectly, this will help in estimating the risk of the drugs both in the animals as well as in the environment, the terrestrial environment. So coming to the guidelines, in India we have Schedule Y, which is for the clinical trials also, and they give guidelines for various phases of the clinical trial, but unfortunately environmental risk assessment studies is not there in Schedule Y like in FDA and European Medicine Evaluation Agency. So next part of the guidelines is the precautionaries and safety measures. So purpose of environmental risk assessment is not to ban drugs or to limit its use, but enable the safe use of medicines and to have alternatives with similar therapeutic effects. So pharmaceutical industries should be encouraged to pay more attention to the environmental impact of their products by designing the environment friendly drugs or the drugs which are biodegradable through controlling stereochemistry of the drug and by minimizing the therapeutic doses. If there is some environmental effect, then there is a need to change the label. And in the label, there should be a clear mentioning that this drug may pose harm to particular animals or humans, especially in pediatrics population or geriatric population. Apart from this, there is a proper guidance for the patient use and product storage and the disposal of the drug. This is another thing. Recently, the three organization, WHO organization for the welfare of animals and the food and agriculture organization of UNO, they come up with the idea of One Health Triad, and this is especially came up with the irrational use of antibiotics, which is causing harm, and especially the antibiotic resistance. So with this, they are promoting healthy people, healthy environment, and healthy animals. Now, next is the problems of unused prescription drugs. When prescription drugs are unused, they may be used irrationally, or there's chances of prescription drug abuse, accidental poisoning, and if they are thrown away, so incidence of drugs found in drinking water. So there are recommendations for proper disposal of drugs. We say that do not flush down all your drugs into the toilet or drain. And there is another program which we call as Take Back Program. And Take Back Program shows that we need to return the unused medicine to the pharmacy. This Take Back Program is very efficient in South African countries. So this should be encouraged in countries where this no take program is there. So federal guidelines also says that wherever there is no take back programs, you need to take this program in your area. Take to the local household hazardous waste program. Do not burn the unused drug. Take your prescription drugs out from the original containers and mix these unused drugs with an undesirable substances, like for example coffee grounds, dirt, and put in a trash. Put this mixture into disposable container with a lid. Conceal or remove any personal information, especially prescription, and then in a sealed container, in a mixture, you can use this in trash. So pharmaceutical waste guidelines are also there. For example, you can dispose the drug in the incineration, or the hazardous substances, they may be used in landfill. So in conclusion, we can say that both human and animals are given drugs orally or parenterally. It may either be fully or poorly absorbed from the GIT and from the absorption area. The unabsorbed drug, they pass into the environment in the form of metabolites or active metabolites through feces. So metabolized products excreted in the environment may be, as I said, metabolites in the form of metabolite or exhalation, or a mixture of both. So once they are excreted into the environment, they enter food chains and concentrate upward and to the larger predators. So, for, as I said in the beginning, pharmacovigilance is all about the activities or the adverse effects of drugs on, at therapeutic doses on animals and humans, but there is a need to study the effects of drug on environment, which is called as ecopharmacology. So this is ecopharmacology describes the entry of chemicals or drugs into the environment through any route at any concentration. They may not be at therapeutic doses, they may be at non-therapeutic doses or entering into the environment at any route, not necessarily from the human. So if the drugs are entering into the environment from human or eliminating from both living organism, from animals or human, then this could be an extension of pharmacovigilance, and this is called as pharmacoenvironmentology. So they need to monitor the effects of drugs not only as a good medical practice, but also to safeguard environment. So in the last take home message is educate the public, reducing the demand for illegal drugs. Sometimes some patients, some consumers ask their doctors to write some drugs for their treatment. If it is not required, then there is no need. So this needs to educate the public. Enhance take back or drop off program, because in most of the countries, even in our country, this is not very popular program, take back program. Persuade the lawmakers to make clearer guidelines and regulation for the strict regulation of drugs which are entering into the environment. Both the consumers and manufacturers, they should assume the responsibility, especially how to dispose the drug through wastewater and household waste. Ask your pharmacist how to dispose of medicines if they are no longer required. So I thank you for this, for listening this lecture patiently. And in the last, I would like to say, if you want to read more about the environmental pharmacology, this is a book, An Introduction to Environmental Pharmacology, which we wrote in 2008. So I hope it will help in explaining more facts about the environmental pharmacology. So once again, thank you so much. Goodbye.